In this topic, we're going to look at some of the fundamentals of federation. When it comes to having Azure, and in particular Azure Active Directory, we often like to use things, techniques like directory synchronization, or to provide a truly single sign-on experience that requires ADFS. So since this is an area that I spend a lot of time in at Microsoft, I find a lot of customers have a lot of confusion. So I often do training sessions with them to help them understand some of the basics. So in this short time here, I want to try to clarify this for you as well. So let's talk about a common term that people talk about is the circle of trust. So we're going to initially talk about this trust relationship. So let's start with something like an ADFS server. Okay. Now, an ADFS server could be on premises, but I want you also to think about this, that we could actually have this in the cloud. And the reason why I would suggest doing that in the cloud is because half the time or more that my customers spend in configuring this is getting all the networking infrastructure in place on premises. And of course, when you do this in cloud, a lot of this is a lot more automatically done for you. So to create a trust relationship, we'll keep this very, very simple. So we have ADFS, and then on the other side of the coin, we're going to have some sort of application that we want to create a trust with, okay? So this, I want to explain some basic terminology, and this is a point of confusion for a lot of people. In the SAML world, or Security Assertion Markup Language world, which is kind of one of the default standards out there, you'll hear terms like this. You'll hear the term IDP, which stands for Identity Provider, and that really kind of makes sense, right? Because when you install ADFS by default, it actually is connected to, and you cannot decouple it from Active Directory. So even if I build this in Azure IaaS, I have to have that built on a domain, I can boot on a domain controller. A lot of people don't want to, but actually in Server 2012 R2, they actually recommend to do it because they made it more secure. How did they do that? They actually got rid of IIS. So that was the main security problem before of installing ADFS on an Active Directory domain controller, because IIS is a potential threat. Now it's been subsumed into HTTP.sys and it's much, much more secure. So I'd recommend to do that and also to do this in the cloud. So this is known as an IDP in the SAML world. The application side has always been known as an SP, or service provider. Okay. Now, just to put into Microsoft terms, and Microsoft's not the only one that does this, but Microsoft has some parallel terms. So an IDP is also known as a CP, or claims provider, or an RP, or a relying party trust. Okay. So the way this works is, if I'm installing and configuring my ADFS server, one of the first things I have to do is do a trust. And as we said, we have this Active Directory trust already in place. But now I want to add an application to it, right? So I have to have a trust relationship with that application. And in this case, it would be known as an RP trust, because that's what it's going to show me in its interface. But you may read some documentation, they'll talk about doing an SP. So what is that trust really about? The trust is really about certificate validation, right? So when I install ADFS, I actually get three certificates. A little ribbon there. So ADFS has a certificate that people can use to validate against me. But likewise, when I install this application, we want to have a secure application, and it's going to have a certificate tied to that. So now we get into the whole world of public key and private key. So if this application wants to sign this, right, so the application has to have its private key, right, which by its nature, you and only you can possess your private key. But I need to know a way to verify that signature from that application, in other words, that I can prove that I trust that person, that it is who they say they are, in this case, the application. So what happens is I have to take this certificate, and you can actually extract that out, and I can make another certificate with a public key. And typically, if you're familiar with certificates, that's going to be an extension in .cer, where the private key is going to be a PFX, right? So we're going to take that public key certificate, and when I install on the Federation server, I'm going to have that over here, okay? Now, I don't want to dive too much deep into the ADFS server, but we can make this very, very simple, and we can actually not even have to physically do that. But if you add these trusts through what's known as a Federation metadata file, It's actually an XML document that will actually read that public key, and therefore we don't have to do anything to establish that trust. Okay. So that's a very, very simplified view that we have a Federation server, which is known as an IDP or a CP, so two different names. IDP is kind of a more generic term, and at Microsoft, in the actual interface, you'll see a claims provider trust. And then we have the application that we're going to add in this, and it could be something even like a SaaS application. So I have a lot of customers that are slowly migrating to the cloud. They start with ADFS on premises. We may then move it into the cloud. Then we add a SaaS application, and it could be connected on premises, but then eventually we create a federation with ADFS on premises to Azure AD to the SaaS application, right? So Azure AD actually acts as a hub. Okay, so I want to take this a step further now and show you the kind of the customer scenario. And I'm bridging this current customer of mine up a little bit further. So this is very, very typical. And we're going to show an on-premises hub and connecting it up to Azure. So let's say we have a central IT department, right? And they like to control everything, like a lot of central IT people do. And they have an ADFS server. Okay, well, this particular agency I'm dealing with, they have several other agencies, and we'll just make little islands here for each one. Okay, and each of these actually are separate forests and separate domains, right? But they want to use this, as I've been talking about, this it's called a time and attendance application, that is gonna have, and of course, this time and attendance application has a trust right now, and this is our first step, bridging into the cloud. So they have this time and attendance SaaS application out there in the cloud. And eventually we can move this and make this federation with ADFS to the cloud. So we'll make the cloud out here, right? Okay, so each of these sub-agencies, again, not part of the domain, these all have a trust with the central ADFS server. So this is where it gets kind of tricky in the trust relationships and understanding. Is that each of these, and this was confusing to my client, so I want to clarify for you too. So we mentioned that before, by default, we actually have a trust with Active Directory, right? And that's a default CP trust that you cannot change. Well, likewise, so this agency, they want to log in. You know, when they're logged in, they get to the app straight through, single sign-on. This one wants to do the same thing in this one. So these, likewise, are added as CP trusts into my Active Directory Federation services. But on the flip side, guess what you do? You have to do the opposite. So when I'm on these servers, I'm gonna make an RP trust or a relying party trust, or some people call an SP trust. And that RP trust will point back to the central IT department's ADFS server. So therefore, we're creating a trust relationship from each agency that goes to a central ADFS server that can talk to a SaaS application, and then eventually we can hook this up with their new Azure subscription they're going. Okay, so that's an example of tying this all together, kind of making a hub and spoke configuration where we can take multiple customer environments that weren't even hooked up through an integrated Active Directory environment, but we had federation trusts based on certificates. And through those, they can all access a central application, which is tied into one organization's IT department, and then eventually we can connect this up to the cloud. So we start slowly migrating to a SaaS application, and then eventually migrating their users. Next step we're going to do is install Azure Active Directory Connect or synchronization to then synchronize all those user accounts up to the cloud, because the new tool, Azure AD Connect, can actually do that for multiple forests. So now we'll have a failover and backup, as we talked about in another topic, where you can have ADFS and Azure AD Sync kind of work in harmony together.
So one question, Mark, when you have these SaaS applications out here, like you mentioned this time and attendance one, is that something that has to exist in the marketplace, like right now, or is that something that it's an industry standard? So as long as the application on the other side supports some sort of a protocol, it will work with this?
So that's a great question. And in my current customer, theirs was not in the application portal at all. So the way we did that, remember what I showed with the trust, and I said instead of actually moving those certificates over, we can do an XML file. Mm-hmm. So they actually had a federation metadata file, and we just pointed to that. And that file is an XML document that reads the certificate, reads the claims, says what they can give, what they can accept. and it made that connection instantaneously. And if for some reason you couldn't get to that, like you don't have internet access, then I could actually have them export it, send it to me, and I can import it in as well.
Cool.
Okay. So there you have it. That concludes some fundamentals of Active Directory Federation services.